Good evening if it's evening, good night if it's night, and a big hearty salam alaikum to each and every one of you that's listening to us live, or will be listening to us in archives. Of course, you're listening to It's 12 O'Clock Somewhere, baby, with Candelo Kimbisa, and we have a very special guest for you today. I am so excited because this is a sister that I truly love, adore, and admire, and she was one of our very first guests on Candelo's Corner. She has so many things wrapped up in one, but most of all, she's a teacher and a very lovely person, and I'm just happy to have her here with us today and give you guys the first look at, or the second look at, or many of you have had many looks at, Miss Ty Shaw, a mambo, a lukumi priestess, and so much other things. So without further ado, Let me let Miss Tyshaw in here and give her a round of applause, everyone. Miss Tyshaw. Salam alaikum, sister.
Malaikum Sala, how are you?
I am absolutely wonderful. I am great. Well, first of all, welcome to It's 12 O'Clock Somewhere, because this is your first appearance here. But I got to tell you that you have been on Candelo's Corner when that was the jumping thing.
I remember, back in the day.
Back in the day, baby. Yes. Miss Tyshaw, we have a lot of people that are here with us now. A lot of people know who you are. But as you know, we have quite a big following now. And some of these people may not know who Tyshaw is. All right? So first of all, let's go on with a little introduction of who Tyshaw is.
Well, I, you know, am just a girl from Brooklyn by way of Panama.
Okay.
Who got a couple of initiations and did some studying, and now I'm here trying to do the best I can. For the most part, I am a sex educator. I focus on helping people with sexual trauma and healing from that.
Right.
Within the religion, I am a Mambo in the Haitian voodoo tradition. I am a Lugumi priestess as well. A Falera, and, you know, a few other things. And, you know, we just do the best we can.
All right. Well, let's break them all down for a minute, okay? I know you've been a Lukumi priestess, but I know you first and foremost as a Palera, as a follower of the Mayumbe tradition, okay?
I would, yep.
Yeah, I know you as being a badass Yayi, okay? And I know you sticking up for, and I appreciate and I love the fact that you always stuck up for people of color, and you are a beacon of light for women in general, especially women of color, okay? And that's important to me. Let me ask you first, okay? Mm-hmm. And a lot of the things that we both have said have been controversial, and I know it has because I got the emails to show from all over the years. But let me ask you, love, what is the role of a woman in the ATRs, okay? Because you got a lot of men, okay? And it's very misogynistic, and you know this, okay? We've all known this, baby, okay? So what, in your perspective, and it's probably mine also, what is your thought on women? What is the role of women inside of First Palo?
Inside of Palo, you said?
Yes, in Palo. Let's go for Palo first, then we'll go for Lukumi, and then we'll go for Voodoo.
Well, I would start in general, women in this tradition are the keepers of this tradition.
Yes.
And in most cases, with a few exceptions, we are also the founders and creators of these traditions.
Yes.
And so, in my opinion, and historically, we have to speak about women when we talk about why we are free in the West on a basic level, and why these traditions continue to exist. In terms of Palo, the Yayi has many, many roles, aside from giving light in the room, from providing guidance, from being the spiritual foundation of a Munan soul, also for being the person, you know, for those of us who have, you know, Uramenga and went through the process of Inkimba, we know that the Tata is checking with the Yayi at every point, because the Yayi has to know everything about ceremony.
Right.
The Yayi is the foundation. That's it. I don't care what anybody has to say.
A
lot of times in this culture, we like to downplay the Yayi as if Yayis don't run Munansos and work with various Tatas to do so, as if Yayis don't play an extreme role not only in seeing and protecting a Munanso, but also passing on the traditions of a lineage.
Yes, because we both know without both, someone can't be born. We know that.
There we go.
And we also know that many of the secrets were bought by Yayis, whether it be in Lukumi, whether it be whatever. the yayi would, I mean, not the yayi, the woman was the person that brought most of these secrets. As in Cuba. Absolutely. And all these places, we know that in Lukumi, that a lot of the secrets were bought by the women. Okay, and a lot of people don't want to see that historical fact in it. You know, the womb is so important in so many things. And most of all, at least for spiritual men, you should know that our religions or our spirituality were brought inside women. Okay, and a lot of people tend to see this or see the sacredness of this.
It you know, the thing is that it's so contradictory to me, because if we talk about Lukumi, you have Lukumi because of black women. I don't care what anybody says. When people talk about Cubans, they want to act like we're not talking about black people in Cuba.
Right.
You know, and black people in general, but black women in particular. If you don't mention the name Efunche Warikondo, Latuang, Obatero, then your ass ain't talking Lukumi.
Right.
And we talking about black women.
And we're talking about people that were actually Obasas, okay? What people don't like to talk about these days.
You don't have Obati Beji, your first Oba, without Latuan and Obatero.
Right.
You don't have that station without these two women.
Right.
So there's no way to talk about this tradition from a historically factual place without talking about the women who created it.
Right.
If you want to talk about why every person of color is free in the entire Western Hemisphere, then you got to mention the name Mambo Sesi Fatima, who presided with Sesi Bukman over that ceremony at Wakaiman that then launched the Haitian Revolution and gave us freedom.
Right.
You can't talk about any of this without black women.
Or my favorite, my absolute favorite, Kimpovita, which I mention a lot of times, and people have simply forgotten about her and forget that there were...
I mean, even if you talk about... Yeah. Even if you talk about Nya Secundina, Nya Filomena, these big yayis who were known for even building their own Nganga.
Right.
That's, I mean, it's like, these are facts. Don't take that up with me. Take that up with history.
Right.
You know?
I absolutely love the fact that you are a person who is very well educated in these spiritualities, sister. So tell me a little bit about the things that you're doing in Atlanta, because I know Atlanta is popping, sister, because of you, because I know that you have a very reputable munaso in Atlanta. I actually know several people that have been initiated into your house in Atlanta. So tell me what's going on in Atlanta, the new awakening, let's call it. Well, it's been awakened for quite a while, but you know what I mean.
Well, you know, I do know what you mean, because there's a place where there's a bit of an awakening, and there's a place where Atlanta is a hotbed of straight-up mess.
Right.
There's a lot of fakery going on in Atlanta. A lot of people are getting caught up in a lot of fake things. So with me in particular, and with my house, I really work to keep things in the most traditional fashion that I can. I include my elders in whatever I do. I try to support my godchildren to the best of my ability. And I don't overextend myself. You know, I don't take any and everybody. I take those who are meant to be in my house. And, you know, just do the best work that I can. Here in Atlanta, Isha Shea is very popular, but not necessarily always the most correct. You know, there's a lot of hybrid stuff in Atlanta. There's a lot of mixing. There's a lot of making up traditions and making up ceremonies. So while Atlanta does present a lot of opportunity, Atlanta is a place where, you know, one really has to be careful, check references, and do their due diligence before they decide to deal with any priest.
Right. So let me, you're also an espiritista, all right? And I know that it's, and I honestly believe that without Egun, none of this is possible, okay? Without sin el muerto no hay nada, as we say in Spanish, okay?
And I
went to Atlanta maybe about 4 months ago, and I had a misa there. I had a spiritual reunion, okay? There were over almost 50 people at the misa.
Oh, yeah.
If I would have had room for 100, there would have been 100 there. if I would have had, mm-hmm. if the space that I had was big enough. So how important is Egun? How important is the veneration or the uplifting or the expanding of Egun inside of all these religions or spiritualities for you and you know, from your point of view?
From my point of view, it's probably the most important part of this tradition, because all of these traditions are ancestral, period.
Right.
Whether, you know, whether that's just coming from a place of being handed down from our ancestors, or whether that's the worship of ancestralized divinities, such as your beloved Shango. You know, the fact of the matter is, okay, Kawo, you know, you don't, even in Ocha, we say Ikulo bi Ocha. That gives birth to Ocha. And that means a lot of things, but it also talks about, on a certain level, the ancestral nature of these traditions. Mm. When it comes to espiritismo, the veneration of one's spirit guides, the work of a spiritualist, and by extension, the development of one's ancestors and spiritual court, you don't get to any of these traditions without the blessings of your ancestors and your spirit guides, period.
Right.
I've worked misas for people with 15, 20 years of Ocha who haven't had a misa since they made Ocha, and Egun and their spirit guides are all over the place as a result.
Right.
No matter where you choose to go, if you are not in constant communication with and working on the development of your ancestors, you're not going to go far. That's your first line of defense. That's the thing you didn't have to pay for to get.
I love that you say that you have to. You didn't have to pay for to get, because we know we have a lot of people charging people these days to get in contact with their ancestors, which is absolutely it's absolute bullshit to me. You know what I'm saying?
You
don't have to pay for ancestry.
You are born with ancestry. You might want to sit down, take your time, and cultivate that relationship and develop that, you know, that in your ori. We are always quick to want to go to the river and go here and go there and worship everything but ourselves. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the day, Orisha cannot give you what ori will not accept.
Mm-hmm.
And what takes you to anything are your dead.
Wow. Beautifully said, sister. Let me backtrack a little bit, because this is a conversation that's been going on online forever. Okay,
mm-hmm.
we all know that the concept has always been here, but has been slightly forgotten. Okay,
mm-hmm.
and we get new people all the time, you know, claiming either ancestor that Lukumi, or you know, that Yoruba is in their bloodline, or that Palo is in their bloodline, that they are good on this by birthright, not knowing that Africa is huge, and just the Bantu section has, you know, 100 different tribes or different different things. Okay, just as Yoruba land. Okay, I always tell people to please to get themselves, and a lot of people will say things like, well, you know, these ancestry tests are not good, blah blah blah, the government conspiracy, blah blah blah, whatever. Okay. So, you know, there are many other tribes. I mean, I got my DNA checked and I found out I had not only Mandingo, but I also had Pygmy. Okay? So, you know, what do you have to say to people that say, hey, you know, this is my ancestral right, I don't need to get initiated, I can just, you know, go pray to Siete Rayos or go to a river, not knowing that the river has 10 different deities, plus the deities that were inside that so-called river, you know, before the Yoruba came, or before the Palo came.
That's right.
Okay?
Right.
So you got Native American spirits that are there. You have all types of spirits that are connected to these rivers, to these crossroads, to these mountains, to whatever it may be. So what do you have to say to those people?
I have a lot to say to those people.
Well, baby, you go on ahead and say it, sister, because you know I will not leave one stone unturned, and we cannot leave here without creating a little bit of controversy.
You know we got to hurt their feelings real quick, because it's like, you know that little bubble? Let's go ahead and boop. Drop that real quick.
Yes.
Because, you know, there's a couple of things. Every one of us that is initiated into one of these traditions has a birthright, because that birthright was chosen before we chose to incarnate. And we come here after we choose to incarnate to fulfill that contract that we made before we got here.
Yes.
Period. It is not about giving you something that you weren't born with. It is about going through the ritual to complete the pact that you were born with. And it is also about the community acknowledgement of that which you were born with. Because when we come to these traditions and we find out whether or not we have a road in it via divination in any one of these systems, that's because that choice was already made. That's a confirmation of one's birthright. Now, initiation is not just about birthright either. It is also about license. It is about access. It is about paying your fare to ride the bus. Because while you are born with your connection, what you are not born with is access to the secret.
Right.
What you are not born with is the knowledge of the technology and how one properly approaches these forces. Because whether you like it or not, the multiverse itself, existence itself, has rules. And your birthright does not absolve you of the responsibility of having to adhere to the rules. That's life. You exist because of the rules and laws of existence.
Yes. Yes, you do.
And so, you know what I'm trying to say? So what initiation is also about is the access to ritual and technology so that you now have the tools necessary to access your birthright. Birthright alone is not enough, my love. Okay?
Wow.
That's number one. Mm-hmm. Number two, I find it really interesting how people feel so free to change black woman tradition. No one goes inside a Catholic church and says, I was born a priest. I'm going to come up in here and I'm going to run, this service here. No one does that.
Mm-hmm.
No one goes into a mosque and tells the imam or whoever that I'm going to, perform shahada right now on myself because I was born this way.
Mm-hmm.
No one does that.
Right.
No one does that with the patriarchal religions. But
right.
some way, somehow, when it is something black and, by extension, feminine in its nature and history, you feel comfortable to do whatever you want with it.
Mm-hmm.
So to those people I say, you are telling me you are born this African as we all are, but you act in the most Western white man way possible.
Mm-hmm.
This is how you appropriate your own shit.
Wow.
Because you don't respect the culture of your own shit. Because if you did, then you would understand that our culture has rules and protocols that were created by our ancestors. So if you really about that ancestor life, you might want to get with the ways in which your ancestors left this medicine for you.
Get it? Well, baby, you know what? We are going to take a little break. But when we come back, because on that same tip, there is a lot of new people, okay? A lot of new people, and maybe some older ones, that are saying that white people do not belong in this tradition, okay? And we need to go on ahead and talk about that, okay? We need to talk about that. So, guys, you are listening to It's 12 O'Clock Somewhere with our special guest, Ty Shaw. I, Candelo Kimbisa, and It's 12 O'Clock Somewhere. We'll be right back.
Everybody get up! Who's that? Dancing to the latest
Is by the late but great Tina Marie. Well, let's join our conversation with Miss Ty Shaw. Ty Shaw, are you still there with us, sister?
Yes, I am.
Well, you know, again, I want to bring up this subject. First of all, I want to tell you that my godmother, Ibaye Ntuno, Chango Dina, was one of these people that grew up old school, okay? And believe it or not, this was one of her sayings, okay? That people of all races, all roads lead to Nsambi, okay? All roads lead to Olodumare. But she also used to say that the only white things in Cuba were the bones, I mean, in Africa were the bones of the white man. I mean, okay, well, let me say it again. She used to say that the only white things in Africa were the bones of the black man, okay? That she understood why people were getting into the religion, but she was sort of kind of hot at it at the same time, okay? But let's go into the fact that everyone now is saying, well, white people do not belong in the ATRs, they shouldn't be in it, they're using our magic against us, and all that new stuff that's going on inside, in and around the internet, and mostly from people that are not even initiated, okay? So let's talk about that a minute.
So, I think it's a conversation that's a little more complicated, you know? Because yes. for me, there are a couple of pieces to it.
Right.
On one end, white folk have never abandoned their magic. You
right.
worship their ancestors on various days of the year. Every time you spend a dollar, every time you see a monument, they've always kept their ancestral traditions. Their biggest ancestor, your Jesus Christ, you continue to worship and exalt, and he's out here cutting up. That's a deified ancestor.
Right.
They've never left their magic alone. You've been oppressed by it, and you chose to be, and you continue to be, for those who choose to continue to follow the death cult that is Christianity.
Right.
Okay. Now, on another end, white folks have gotten into these traditions and have worked hard at preserving it, being good priests, and all of these things, while many black folk were still calling us devil worshippers.
Right.
When you didn't want your shit, white people were here for it.
Right.
So, you know, you got to work on that piece too. On another level, I'm sorry, are you moving a bag or something?
Yes, I was. I'm sorry, sweetie.
Okay.
I
all good. No worries. On another level, for me, it also depends on the tradition we're talking about.
Right.
For me, it's challenging if you're talking about white people in Palo,
mm-hmm.
white people in Voodoo, because now you're talking about traditions that were kind of specifically created for our liberation and
right.
that you spent a lot of time demonizing.
Right.
When it comes to Orisha and Ifa, I feel a little more flexible on those because I feel as though Orisha seeks to populate the world.
Yes.
Orisha chooses who they choose. Ifa chooses what they choose. And they weren't necessarily created for our liberation.
Right.
Palo doesn't exist in Africa.
Right.
African animist traditions exist in Africa. But mm-hmm. those traditions made it over to Cuba and converged in different ways to form what we have as Palo.
Mm-hmm.
Palo is not African per se.
Mm-hmm.
Palo is African inspired. Palo is African rooted. But it is most certainly distinctly a diaspora tradition.
Amen.
You're not going to get scratched in Africa. You're not going to get scratched in Africa.
Right.
But you'll make Orisha in Africa. You'll make Ifa in Africa. Those are not technologies that existed solely for our liberation. So for me, it falls down to the nuances of what tradition are we talking about?
Right.
You know? When you're talking about Palo and Voodoo, that's a little tougher for me.
Right.
That's a little like, And Palo in particular doesn't claim to be for everybody.
Right.
It's an initiatory-only private society.
Hmm.
That's why you can't just Google about Palo. You need
right.
to get licensed to even ask those questions.
Right.
Okay? And at the end of the day, there's a lot of places where I would describe Palo as a religio-spiritual protest cult. It's
hmm.
about liberation. As is Voodoo.
Mm-hmm.
And your main oppressor in this particular world is whiteness, and by extension, humans who call themselves white.
Right.
But when you're talking about Orisha and Ifa, especially the cult of Ifa, which mm-hmm. nobody wants to talk about, but had a lot to do in facilitating your enslavement, I don't know that that's ever been anti-white.
Right. Woo, you just dropped a bomb, sister. Well, let me go on ahead and say hi to everybody that's listening to us today. We have Mr. Obatala. We have Art K. Gomez. We have Mambo Yanza. We have Miss Lawrence Thomas. We have Miss Jasmine Bellamy, Miss Yvette from the MotownWitch.com and from the Motown Witch in beautiful Detroit, which I will be in this year. Yes, we have Miss Crystal, Miss Nicole, Miss Chantel, all the way from the UK, Miss Fatima, Princess Moore. That is a rebel and a half. Let's talk about Miss Regina Holder and everybody else that's listening to us today. Miss Josette, how you doing, sister? Nice seeing you again. Well, we got a lot of people in here, but let me tell you something. We have a lot of people listening to us on YouTube. We have a lot of people listening to us on Facebook. If you want to come and join our popping chat room, please do come on in. It's at Spreaker.com. Just follow the link, follow us, and we'll have a good time. You can join us. Miss Kenya T. Kovic just joined us. Yes, she says, thank you. Say that again. I've been preaching about this forever and just gave me life. How are you going to love something that you won't even know if your ancestors were enslaved or sold by it? Thank you, thank you, thank you. See, I guess that message is for you, Ty. Well, there we go. Sister, there is some other things you're doing, okay? I have followed this for a while, and being part of some of these lifestyles, I absolutely love what you're doing, okay? Let's talk about the other aspect and the other things that you're doing, okay? The liberation of spiritual sexuality and for people of color. Can you please tell us a little bit of something about that?
Absolutely. I decided to focus on the intersection of spirituality and sexuality because of a number of reasons. Number one, from being a priest or being a spiritual worker, 90% of the people we see have some sort of sexual trauma.
Whether men or women. Because I talked about that the other day, how some men are need healing also. But go ahead, sister.
Absolutely. And we downplay that. Men, especially men of color, have just as much trauma as the sisters out here sexually on a lot of levels. And when you bring it to these traditions, our traditions tend to be very conservative and shy away from conversations about sex, which is absurd to me on so many levels I can't even explain. Because at its most basic, everything we do is sexual in nature. We give birth to divinities. Birth does not happen without copulation and insemination. Every time you sit in front of an awo ifa and you receive a dafa, and that awo begins to pound ikim so that it can give birth to an odu, he or she is mimicking copulation. Everything we do is sexual in nature. This is why we have men and women involved, the duality of masculine and feminine, to give birth to divinity. Birth also does not happen without blood, right? So at the end of the day, it's about technology and it is about sexuality. And we engage in these rituals that give us heightened access to spiritual energy. And if anyone knows anything about physics, energy is neither created nor destroyed, merely transferred from one point to another. There is no difference between your sexual energy and your spiritual energy. And if we don't have conversations and technologies for how we mitigate energy, particularly of the sexual nature, with the level of work we do in these traditions, we're setting ourselves up for what we see now, which is rampant abuse. Okay. And no way of dealing and healing the people who have been abused in and out of these traditions. Because we refuse to have the conversations around the obvious. And the obvious is we deal with sexual energy every time we engage in ritual.
And
so, yeah.
No, go ahead. Please.
You know,
continue.
So for me, my work really is in helping people to heal from sexual trauma, understanding the nature of sexual energy, and using that for your liberation. Because if these traditions truly are about us developing ourselves, healing our ancestry, we can't do that without ownership of the body and, by extension, ownership of the sex. There is no way. That was raped and beaten out of us. That's what they want to own, your body, your right to pleasure, your access to your spiritual power, which is directly connected to your sexuality. There is no way for you to live in a liberated existence without dealing with that.
And I gotta tell you, sister, because, you know, and I know you've been doing this for a while, as I've been doing it for a while, and I see a lot of people coming to me daily, okay, that other readers or other people, or they feel like they have ancestral curses, okay?
Mm-hmm.
We know that everything in this life has a beginning and an end, okay? And even something that your grandmother did, or your great-great-great-great-grandmother did, or grandfather, has a beginning and an end, okay? What I'm seeing is a lot of ancestral trauma, okay? What is your thought on ancestral trauma?
I think most of us, I think there's no way to be a person of color in the West and not have ancestral trauma.
Right.
I think that's the nature of our existence. We can take that from a scientific perspective and get into the epigenetics of it all. But we understand that things like racism, poverty, various things actually have genetic code and are handed down in the DNA. This is not something we're just making up. So when we come to these traditions, we're looking for healing. And when we get initiated into these traditions, doubling back to those who feel it's their birthright, part of what initiation also does is the upliftment of one's ancestry so that you can begin to resolve and heal that generational trauma. So it's not about you. It's not about your ego. Initiation is also a sacrifice on behalf of your ancestors.
Yes. Yes, 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 yes. So that's, wow. And I also see that you give classes on these things. Some of them may seem a little bit wild for people. You know, it has a sort of like a DS sort of connotation to it. Okay, how does this work out, and how do you put that into your work, in as far as healing goes?
So when it comes to classes on sexuality, people pretty much hire me to teach about anything from BDSM and DS lifestyles to tantra. And really getting into a sacred space with your sexuality.
Right.
At the end of the day, when you begin to heal sexually, whether it's through acknowledging your desire in kink, whether it's through healing from molestation, what you're really dealing with is the retraining of the nervous system and the manipulation of polarity.
Right.
Even on the kinkier, far outside, BDSM is nothing but polarity play.
Right.
There's a masculine and feminine, a top or bottom, a dominant or a submissive. And it's within the manipulation of those energies that you are liberating the self through desire, through the acknowledgement and placation of said desire, and through that truth telling. You know what I'm trying to say?
I know exactly what you're saying.
I mean, outside of really working towards healing trauma with my own godchildren, I don't, you know, necessarily blur those lines or cross those boundaries.
Right.
So my clients are typically not in my spiritual house, per se.
Right.
But if I do have a godchild with sexual trauma who has been raped or molested or abused in some form or fashion, what I have developed is a network of therapists. Many of my godchildren are therapists as well. Mm-hmm. And the support systems necessary to provide that healing. I also do the energy work to assist them in that, past life regressions, etc. Mm-hmm. Additional spiritual tools beyond and outside of this tradition that can provide a holistic healing practice. Because it's not always about chickens. Sometimes what folks need is therapy.
Right. Well, I was just gonna bring that up. Okay, the misdiagnosis. Okay.
Right.
There is a lot of misdiagnosis. Okay.
Absolutely.
How many people, you know, and it's funny because you know we're in the spiritual thing, we're in the spiritual process, and in the spiritual enlightenment, and a lot of people think that you know it's a spirit or it's a curse. Or maybe sometimes they even think that it's an ancestor thing. And a lot of times I see that people need to speak to the man in the white coat, as they say, okay? Mm-hmm. They need to speak to the therapist. They need to go seek psychological help and things of that sort. What is your thinking on this?
I think that absolutely there's a lot of misdiagnosis because it's a little complicated, you know. There's a place where, from an African perspective, mental illness or any illness really is spiritual in nature because what we see here manifests in the realm of spirit before it manifests in the physical body, right?
Right.
However, we have to understand our limitations with that too because if you're not a licensed professional, do you really have the wherewithal to distinguish, you know, a causa from a schizophrenic personality?
Right.
And are you assuming that you know something you don't?
Right.
Because at the end of the day, while yes, one could argue that every form of illness is spiritual in nature and they wouldn't necessarily be wrong.
Right.
Sometimes the Ebola is not the chicken. It
yes.
is the conversation.
Right.
It is the release of the trauma through psychotherapy. It's taking your freaking medication because what you have is a hormonal imbalance, mm-hmm. not the devil on your ass.
Right. Wow.
And
thank
so as
you.
Priests, we have to have the wherewithal to tell the truth. Mm-hmm. And if we don't know, we don't know. Maybe you need to bring in a second opinion.
Right. Right. And we all know, sister, because, you know, we at least us older ones, we know our limitations. Okay, there is no there's no doctor do it all in any of these spiritualities.
Right.
Okay, I have to sometimes send someone to, let's say, to the foot of Ifa. Okay, I have to send someone to, you know, to sometimes I even have to say, you know what, your problem. Okay, I am a male. Okay. I still have a little bit of misogynist tendencies in me. Okay, I honestly do. I'm a man. Okay, so I say, you know what, sister? You know, it's better maybe for you to go see this lady. Okay, it is better for you to see this mambo, this priestess in this, because she can connect with you more with your problem, with your particular problem. Okay,
mm-hmm.
Do you see more of this or less of this?
I have seen less of it, unfortunately, over the years because, you know, people kind of want to be the jack of all trades. And I think it's sad. I think it takes away from community and the fact that we don't have to have the pressure of having to do it all.
Right.
It's a lot being a priest. It's a lot. I'm sorry, those are my birds.
Oh, don't worry.
It's a lot. Being a priest running a community or a house, and at the end of the day you need support, especially if you intend to maintain a life while you're doing all of this spiritual whatnot.
Right.
And in order to do that, you got to develop a community.
Right.
And there is something to be said about developing a specialty.
Right.
And being really good at the thing that you do.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And there was a time where we had specialties. We didn't do everything.
Right.
You had the one person that they were known for cooking. You always hired them to cook. That's what they do.
Mm-hmm.
Another person is the Osainista. You call the Osainista. You know they're going to have the herbs for your ceremony. That's what they do.
Right.
You know what I'm trying to say?
Right.
Now, me personally in my practice, I am good for referring people out.
Right.
Because if it is not a problem, I think is within my pay grade, or something that I can support, or even if it's just simply a personality issue where I feel like there is another priest who would be more suitable to your sensibilities, that's where I'm going to send you.
And that's good, because you know me, child. I say a lot of fucks and shit and all this. And a lot of people, you know, say, well, he's not priestly, okay? And I'm like, dude, you know, what is a fucking priest? Okay, am I supposed to walk around here with a turban on my head and you know, speak of love and light all the time? You understand? And
yeah, that's not real. That's not life.
That's not right. So, you know, please say something about the fact, you know, how spiritual people work, okay, as opposed to how people want them to look, which is a big fucking thing these days, because I guess the internet and television and all these things here. Have people thinking, well, if he doesn't have a Mercedes in his yard, he can't help me with prosperity or things of that sort, okay? So please, let's expound on that a little bit.
I think it's a very Western approach to African ideas.
Right.
That's what I think. Because, and which is not unusual, unfortunately. At the end of the day, priests are human beings with contracts with otherworldly forces.
Right.
They're not the Pope. And while your Pope is dressed in royal garb, he's fucking little boys.
Exactly.
So it says to me that your priorities are fucked up. Because
right.
you need your priest to look this way so that you can feel good about giving them the deference that they deserve. That sounds
right.
like a personal issue. not the responsibility of a priest.
Yes.
Your responsibility as a priest is to care for your deities, to uphold your contract, and if you are crowned, to wear your crown well. Mm-hmm. Nowhere in the agreements that we made, did it say that we have to speak in the fashion that people want us to, dress in the fashion that they want us to make them feel good about it. Because you know what? There are a lot of people who wear the 50 million alekes,
Every
day ever known a man on, have their fine ashoke on in the bembe, and they are the most Yoruba of the Yorubas, honey. Mm. And that's the motherfucker who raped the girl last week.
Right.
So it's like, what do you want? Do you want the substance, or do you want the look?
Well, I'm glad you brought up the elekes, boy, because I see them all the time. And as well, you know, I have been initiated into Lukumi. I have been initiated into mm-hmm. Palo, and I have several other initiations that I don't even talk about. But the thousand elekes, see, people don't seem to know that each one of these elekes represents an orisha or something that we got or that we received. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So please, let's talk a little bit about the elekes, because you know these stores are becoming rich just off of selling elekes, whether it be online
mm-hmm.
or whether it be mm-hmm. on brick and mortar stores. Okay. And I've seen people, you know, with 1,000 elekes. You know, yo soy fresco. You know,
mm-hmm.
yeah, I'm a little bold. And I ask people, mm-hmm. you know, what, why do you have that on? You know, are you initiated? You know, whatever. And then I go down the line of, you know, the ones that I know, because we all know that there are hundreds of different orisha,
mm-hmm.
okay?
Mm-hmm.
And people are given these through a lifetime, okay? You don't mm-hmm. receive all of them at one time, okay?
Mm-hmm.
mm-hmm. So what is your thought on
that? Oh, it's a mess. So there are two schools of thought on this. I'm going to speak from the Lukumi perspective, okay? Because from an Ishesha perspective, some things are a little different.
Yes.
From an Ishesha perspective, you know, there's not as much of a problem of people just, you know, liking an eleke and wearing it, whether it says jewelry or whatever, and maybe it didn't go through ceremony because they don't have eleke ceremony in the way that we have it.
Right.
Although you do receive initiatory beads when you do things Ishesha. There isn't as much.
Could you please, Chai? I'm sorry. I'm cutting you off. Could you please explain Ishesha and explain Lukumi? Because you know you're saying Lukumi perspective,
sure.
Ishesha perspective,
yeah.
And people are probably like,
right.
"What the hell is Ishesha? What is Lukumi?"
Okay.
Yeah.
So Asini Bile, what I'm speaking of is Orisha and Ifa tradition as it is practiced currently in the various parts of Yoruba land. That's what I'm referring to as Ishesha.
Okay.
Right? That is different than what we call Lukumi, which is the diaspora interpretation of Orisha and Ifa worship. And when I talk about Asini Bile or Ishesha, I don't want people to assume that everybody in Yoruba land is doing things exactly the same, because that's
right.
a lie too.
Right.
Region to region, how things are done in Osogbo are not necessarily how things are done in Oyo, and they may be different from how things are done in, you know, in Abeokuta or wherever else. You understand?
Mm-hmm. Right.
So people try to speak about Orisha tradition as if it's some sort of monolith, and mm-hmm. it's not. Even in Yoruba land, there are differences.
Mm-hmm.
And in Lukumi, of course, we have some differences line to line or whatever, but for the most part, we agree on a lot of things.
Mm-hmm.
Now, from a Lukumi perspective, elekes are not just jewelry,
mm-hmm.
okay? They identify you as an aborisha. They identify you on a certain level as a member of a house. Because when you receive the ceremony of elekes, we consider that a level of initiation. A novice level, but it is a level of initiation. And it brings you under the tutelage and protection of that priest's orishas. We don't just put on, you know, beads from the store.
Right.
Beads are prepared according to the roads of the orisha of the priest who is giving them to you. So So my Yemaya Aleke may not look like the next house's Yemaya Aleke. We may have two different Yemayas. So what you have to understand is in Orisha and Lukumi, we've had priests consecrate that talisman or that amulet specifically for you, for your protection. That means priests have gathered, they've broken leaves, they've sung the songs, they've prayed to activate the medicine to adorn you in this protection. That doesn't happen just buying it for $10 from the Botanica. That's not the same. So when a priest walks up to you or a person in this tradition, period, that has received their eleques, and you're telling them, oh, me and you got the same thing, that's a lie. No, you don't. You don't know, because what that person has is medicine. What you have on is jewelry.
Right.
And you need to understand the difference.
Right. I just had someone say something on the thing. Someone came in my store yesterday. She showed me her PayPal receipt to a local Baba here in Detroit. She paid $900 for a couple of elekes. No ceremony, no ritual, no nothing. Sigh.
Damn. That's cold-blooded.
Cold-blooded.
First of all, don't cost $900.
Child, okay? Let me tell you something. I had a guy walk into my house one day when I was living in Florida. There was a guy in Opa-locka giving out elekes for maybe about $30 a piece. And what he did was grab a bottle of a can of Indio thing, and he would spray them with that, and he would put them on the person's neck.
Oh wow!
Okay.
Oh wow!
So when he comes into my munazo, the first thing I tell him is where you get that shit from, because my you sabe que muerto chismoso, and muerto's very 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 gossipy. Okay, he tells me he tells me the story. He tells me all that, whatever. And I tell him take that shit off. The first thing I told him. And you know, we did the ritual, whatever. I gave him a necklace, for the house. And then when he went around his neighbor, who was actually initiated into something, his neighbor and a tremendo espiritista, told him, man, wow, you know, now you got the real shit on. That other shit you had was bullshit.
Okay. Okay.
You know, and I feel sorry for people that come into these situations. But child, if you go to pick up a car, if you go to buy a car, if you go and go see a doctor and they tell you need this sort of operation, whatever it may be. I mean, you go for a second opinion. You look into this. You use due diligence. So I don't understand why people these days aren't doing due diligence with spirituality.
I don't think they know. Right. And I think that's one of the things. They don't know what to ask. They don't know what the criteria is that makes someone real or someone fake.
Right.
And so as priests, we have to do a better job of communicating what those questions should be. And where do they begin? And what does doing your due diligence really look like? Because some priests or some fakers make themselves sound legit because they associate with people who are legit.
Right.
They may wear the garb. They got on 50 million beans. They may have a bunch of shit in their house. So, of course, they got to be legit, right?
Right.
To a person who don't know and doesn't know what real looks like, where do they even begin?
Right.
I think that's the problem. And oftentimes, as many of us know, we don't always come to these traditions in peace.
Right.
We come trying to fix some shit. We in war. Somebody trying to get us. You know, something is going on. And we're so preoccupied with getting the solution to our problem that we don't take the time to pay attention to the red flag and ask the right questions.
And it's crazy because in this internet age, sweetie, everybody knows somebody. Okay?
That's right. We're easily verifiable.
Easily verifiable. Lord knows more of my shit has come out in these last 15 years than ever in my life. You know what I mean?
Right.
So, you know, it's not like it's not verifiable. Okay?
Right.
Who this person is, who were their initiators? How long have they been doing this? You know, these are important questions. And I don't, you know, and like I said, people, and again, you know, this internet is so fucking crazy because it's like the new Marine logo. Be all you can be.
Mm-hmm. Okay?
And you know you've had it because I've had it. You know, people that were in people that have been inside of your inbox, okay, 2-3 years ago, asking you a multitude of questions about the spirituality that are now so-called big wigs and giving advice and taking people's money for work. And I would, and I'd be like, man, this son of a bitch, the other day, this son of a bitch was asking me questions.
Absolutely. You know, the thing is due diligence. So for a new person, you need to verify. Mm-hmm. When you speak to a priest, you got to ask, okay, where were you initiated? When? Who were the people that initiated you? To what lineage? What style of this practice do you practice? What tradition? Do you have a house? You know, like, you got to ask.
Right.
And who can verify this information? No legit priest is going to be offended by that, because every legit priest out here knows what's up right now.
Right.
Nobody's going to be offended by those questions. And, you know, the overnight stars online, it's just a very millennial phenomenon. Because I promise you, the motherfuckers that are really getting down, they ain't online like that.
Right.
They not. Okay? They ain't got time because they busy. All right.
Right?
So, at the end of the day, people want to go, again, chasing clout, chasing the look and not the substance, and then they get caught up.
Right.
You know, you got to verify. Any one of us or anybody that's out there that claims to be a legitimate priest is verifiable.
Right.
I'm happy to refer people to my godparents. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
You know, if you want to know about me, you're welcome to ask Padrino.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Because I don't have no shame around that. That's what you need to do.
Right. And you're right. There's certain words and certain phrases, and even like in Apollo House, if you were to say your Apollo name, mm-hmm. you know what I'm saying? Or part of your Apollo name, a Palero would be able to say, well, yeah, he's whatever, okay?
Exactly.
You know, most of us don't say our real Ocha names, but, you know, you can say, hey, you know, that Pimienta, or, you know, like myself, I was initiated into Lucumí in La Vieja Habana by Ricardito Muñanga. Mm-hmm. My godmother's name is whatever her name is, and so on and so forth, okay? There are ways to get around this, you know, but, again, everybody's looking for McDonald's types, McDonald type, fast food type, you know, initiations, fast food teachings, and things of that sort. We all know, and as well you know, okay, that our teaching still continues, or our learning still continues, okay? Because I have learned, things, and I continue to learn things, okay, on a daily basis. While sitting down with other elders, while sitting down with other people, while sitting down with this is a tradition where you're forever learning, okay? And and of course, whatever Egun and spirit tells you, okay? Because that's another thing that I see, you know, that people say, well, that he's doing it wrong. Why? Because you read it out of some book and that's the way they taught you. The connection to spirit, okay? The connection to spirit is very important in these traditions, okay?
Yes.
Divination is very important in these religions. I also see a lot of people that say, well, I need some love work. And someone will say, well, give me $2,000 and I'll bring that person back. Without divination. I mean, does your spirit really want you to be back with that person? Does spirit want to do the work to get you back with that person?
Right.
You know, so let's talk a little bit about love work, baby, because please. Let's talk a little bit about love work, child. You know, my godmother, Changodina, told me a long time ago, she says, listen, I will show you how to do love work, but I'd rather you not do it. And to this day, I still don't do love work. That's one of the things I do.
Yeah, I don't do love work.
Because I believe it's a form of manipulation, one.
Mm-hmm.
I also think it's done out of spite. Because why would someone be with someone that did them so fucking wrong?
Mm-hmm.
You understand? He left you, the kids.
Yeah, I do.
He stole their fucking money out the bank. You know, he had sex with your best friend. Why would you want that person back if not out of spite? But let's talk a little bit about love work, please.
I don't do love work. I don't do love work because I don't think that it's worth it.
Right.
I just don't think that it's worth it. I haven't necessarily met a man yet that was worth me killing a chicken for.
Right.
Like, I don't, you know, for me, you're creating something that is not there. So you know within your heart and mind that it is not this person's choice.
Right.
And I am big on liberation.
Right.
And love work is the type of work you really got to be on top of.
Right.
Because when that person starts feeling different or something else is going on, you got to be on top of it, on top of it, on top. I don't have the time for love work.
Right.
So that's another reason why. And I don't think the manipulation is worth it. And also, 9 times out of 10, people who want love work, you know, the relationship wasn't a healthy one to begin with.
Right.
Now, that's too much. Mm-hmm. Now, if we were talking about you are in a relationship and you guys want to do some work to protect your union or to improve your relationship, or you want to do some work to make yourself, you know, maybe more attractive so maybe you can meet somebody.
Mm.
Or help yourself get back out there because you're just getting out of a relationship or whatever. That's one thing.
Right.
That's one thing. But to be bringing back a lover or to be taking people husband or all this mess, no. I'm not going there with you. Mm-mm.
Well, you know, I love that thought because I often tell people, you know, if you want to do love work, make love work to make your love stronger, to make your bond stronger while you're with this person. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Let's do something
protect
so it can be stronger
union,
at this point.
Protect your marriage, your family.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Mm-hmm.
Well, love, you know, we're coming to the end of the show. We actually ran over, but it was wonderful. Please do tell people where they can see you, where they can take your classes, join your groups, because it's important for people to be able to reach out to you, okay? I consider you a good friend, a good teacher, and a good healer. So please tell them where they can meet you and see you.
Ashe, I appreciate that. Thank you.
You got it.
And Igualmente, of course. You know, they can find me on the Facebook, you know, Ty Shaw. I don't have any groups. I try to stay away from the Facebook groups. I can be found on the Instagram at Real Ty Supreme. And that's just Ty, T-Y. Or on my website, iamtyshaw.com.
There you go. Guys, you have heard it from the witch's mouth. Ty Shaw, Ty Shaw, Ty Shaw. Thank you for coming here and sharing with us, sister. Our platform is always open for you, okay? I hope to have you join me on one of my many adventures, okay? Because you do public speaking also, don't you?
I do. I'm going to be speaking at the Sacred Waters Retreat this year and a couple of other venues, so I hope to see you guys there.
Well, good. Good. The Sacred Waters Retreat, where is that? Hello?
Sorry, I muted it because my dog. Sorry.
Okay, it's not a problem. I got dogs that like to talk when I'm talking too.
Exactly. You know, these crazy dogs. So we're going to be in Tennessee in May. You can go, you know, you can simply go to Sacred Waters Retreat. Just Google Sacred Waters Retreat and you'll see it. It's going to be another one in Costa Rica, but I will be at the one in Tennessee.
Okay.
And it's going to be a lot of lovely elders there giving various workshops, just bringing women of color, you know, together and honoring the ancestors. That's the theme of this year's retreat.
Good. Mm-hmm. I know that there's some sisters in the East Coast that do also Daughters of the Moon and things of that sort for women of color, and I'm absolutely loving it. There are several shop owners that listen to us each and every day, like the people at Wicked Mojo, the people at the Conjure Shop, the people at themotownwitch.com, the people at, Conjure New Orleans, the people at Ritualcraft. So, guys, if you want a true, real sister to come around there and give a lecture or give a thing, please do speak to Ty Shaw, because I'm trying to get her in, not this year, but next year, to come to the Mile High Conjure Gala with us. Because I think that the Mile High Conjure Gala will do great with a sister like you. So all you have to do is tell me a year in advance if you down, sister, and you will be on the ticket, and you're just going to love Denver, Colorado.
Oh, you know, I'm always down, and I've been trying to get to Colorado for a while. So, you know, just keep me posted, and I'm there.
All right, all right. Well, thank you, Ty Shaw. Thank you for coming in and sharing with us.
Thank you. I appreciate it. I'm going to jump off. I actually have a Yawo on the throne this week. So.
Wow. Okay. Yeah. All right, sister. Salam alaikum, and thank you for coming in to It's 12 o'clock somewhere.
Okay, my alaikum salam. Take care.
Well, guys, I hope you had a wonderful time today. Of course, next week we will have someone else on the line, someone else on the show. I'm trying to get Brujo Sancista Luis on so he can talk a little bit more about spiritualism. And until next time, may all the eguns and shadows that accompany you have all the necessary light. From where I sit, that's it. Salam alaikum, everyone. Sexual healing is 12 O'Clock Somewhere was brought to you by ProfessorCharlesPorterfield.com, TheMotownWitch.com, Kimbisa.org, and the Mile High Conjure Gala.